All right, we are back. I'm Nicole Sandler coming to you live at RadioOrNot.com, SoFloRadio.com, TalkRadio1.com, and ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. Lots of different ways to listen. All the links are on the website at RadioOrNot.com under the Listen Live or Watch Live tab. Just find the one that works for you. We are also podcast for free. Shortly after the show, the podcast goes up. It's available in all those usual outlets. We're on Stitcher. Lots of ways to listen. I just I hope you will. Especially now, because this is one of those stories. Look, the whole world or the whole country is preoccupied right now with the idiocy of Todd Akin, right? And yet the mainstream media is ignoring the story of Don Siegelman. This is a story that everybody should know about, and frankly, everybody should be outraged about. Don Siegelman was the governor of Alabama, actually a very popular Democratic governor. How shocking is that? I know, a Democrat, popular in Alabama. Well, I'm going to do a very short rundown here. Basically, Karl Rove and his cronies were not at all happy about the fact that Don Siegelman was a popular Democrat. And so they did everything possible to discredit him, to run him out of the races back in 2002 and then again in 2006. And finally, what they did was they set him up. And he is now really a political prisoner. Don Siegelman was, I think, framed. He was charged with bribery, something that, you know, is ridiculous because he took a political contribution. Well, you know what? Let's get Don Siegelman on the line. The bottom line is Don Siegelman is supposed to report back to prison on September 11th.
Good morning,
if
Don
something
Siegelman.
Doesn't happen. Governor Siegelman, Nicole Sandler calling. Thanks so much for coming on with us again. Now, a lot of people who are listening now heard our interview on Friday. You joined me on the Randy Rhodes show, but I'm so happy that you could join us this morning because, as people know, the shows on regular terrestrial commercial radio are tightly formatted. We only had a few minutes to talk, and I think your story needs to be told in a way that people who are not familiar with what happened to you really know what happened. Because as horrible as it is, what was done to you, the fact that this happens in the United States of America today in 2012 is something that everybody needs to be aware of, so that we make sure not only that you know that justice is served in your case, but this doesn't happen to anybody else. And the fact that it could happen to you, a very highly respected governor of the state of Alabama, just shows that this could happen to anybody. So Don Siegelman, again, as I was explaining right before I got you on the phone, if we don't do something, if there is a petition up, and I'll give this website out a number of times during our talk today, change.org/pardondon. If somebody doesn't step in from the White House to change this, you report back to jail on September 11th for the next 6 years?
That's right. Another way to get to the website is just donsiegelman.org. It's S-I-E-G-E-L-M-A-N, I before E.
Right.
As you explained on Friday,
right.
Some basic spelling tips. But let me just recap briefly for your listeners, and then we can go into depth on some of these things. Because people always ask me, well, why would Karl Rove even care about you? But we have sworn testimony that Karl Rove directed the Department of Justice to, quote, pursue Don Siegelman. We know that Karl Rove's best friend was serving as my opponent's campaign manager while his wife, the George Bush-appointed Karl Rove-anointed prosecutor, was investigating and starting the indictment process against me, leaking stories to the newspapers to damage my chances for re-election. We know that I was brought to trial 1 month before my re-election in 2006, again by the wife of Karl Rove's best friend in Alabama. And the list of Karl Rove fingerprints on this case goes on, and I'll be happy to go into that. We also know that Jack Abramoff, in his book recently published, admits that he spent $20 million of Indian casino money in Alabama and that I was his top priority, and that he says I had to be, Don Siegelman had to be stopped. He sent Grover Norquist in to do dirty work in Alabama as well in 1999 when I was trying to get the Alabama Education Lottery established so kids could go to college for free. You may remember, too, that it was Karl Rove's partner and a man who immediately went to work for Dan, went to work for Jack Abramoff, Dan Gans, who claimed credit for stealing my election in 2002. And it was Karl Rove's client, the Attorney General of Alabama, who stepped in and refused to allow us to have a hand recount of just one precinct where some 5,000 votes, my votes, went missing after midnight, after the votes, the polls were closed and the votes had been counted and I had been declared the winner by all the major CBS, ABC, NBC, CNN, and the rest. So people wonder why Karl Rove would be involved. In 1992, after the Bush-Quayle debacle and Clinton was elected, George Bush ran Karl Rove off. He, Karl Rove, and his best friend, Bill Canary, moved to Alabama and set up shop here. They both married ladies. They both married women from Alabama. Karl Rove settled on the Gulf Coast at a place called Rosemary Beach, and he and his best friend, Bill Canary, started running campaigns to take over the Alabama Supreme Court, as Rove did in Texas. And they used the same tactics here on me as they did in Texas on Jim Hightower and others, and that is to leak information about investigations and that kind of thing to try to do damage to, you know, their opponents. But I started doing battle with Karl Rove in 1994 when he tried to steal his first election, that of the state Supreme Court Chief Justice. And then we did battle again in 96 and 98 and 2000, 2002 and 2006, but that's basically the story of Karl Rove and his involvement in Alabama. But we know that Rove used the Department of Justice as a political weapon, as a tool to win elections. He even went so far as to fire Republican U.S. attorneys who were not pursuing Democrats, like David Iglesias.
Let me step in here for a second, because this is another issue that people will remember, the whole U.S. attorney scandal. Usually, and we're speaking with Governor Don Siegelman, who's relating just an unbelievable story, but it is true. We remember that during the Bush administration, when a new administration comes in, the usual practice is they fire all the U.S. attorneys and replace them with their own people, as did George W. Bush when he came into office. But somewhere midway through his term, they realized that many of these U.S. attorneys were not doing their political bidding the way they wanted them to, so they fired a whole bunch of them who weren't, again, just doing what they politically wanted them to do, and replaced them with their own puppets, if you will. So this is where you came in, right?
Yeah, and in those states where the U.S. attorneys were doing what Rove and Bush wanted done, even if they lost cases, they were praised and given a pat on the back and were allowed to stay on. But if the Republican U.S. attorneys did not do what they were expected to do politically, then they were fired and replaced with people who would pursue Democrats. And, you know, I found myself caught between Karl Rove and political operatives in Alabama who wanted me out of the way. Even a state Republican attorney general from Arizona, who was John McCain's national campaign co-chairman, Grant Woods, said that they couldn't beat Siegelman fair and square, so they targeted him with this prosecution. Those are the words of a Republican attorney general from Arizona. The problem that I have now is that, you know, I had a judge who either was selected or decided he wanted to take this case. He and I had had political battles, a major political battle back in 2002. And anyway, we tried to get him recused and failed. So anyway, I faced a judge who had a grudge against me. And I now stand convicted of bribery as the only person going to jail ever in the history of the United States for raising money for an issue advocacy campaign. Wasn't raising money for my own campaign. I was raising money to establish free college education for all of Alabama's children, and where there was no self-enrichment scheme. I was convicted under a new standard where jurors were allowed to infer that there was an agreement rather than, you know, having, you know, proof beyond a reasonable doubt. They were able to, the judge allowed them to, quote, infer that there was an agreement. The guy that was the supposed briber, the contributor, had I reappointed to a board, a non-paying part-time board on which he had served through three previous governors. So I was the fourth governor in a row to appoint the CEO of a Fortune 500 company to a board on which he had served.
Oh my God.
For nearly 12 years.
Wow. That's an important point to make, because that I wasn't even aware of. So they accused you of accepting a bribe for a fund to help send underprivileged kids in Alabama to college. And the payoff was that he would donate to this fund and you would appoint him to this board, but he had already served on the board.
Yeah, for 12 years through one Republican and two Democratic.
Oh my God.
Two Democratic governors, or no, two Republicans and one Democratic governor. But so this is an unusual case for lots of reasons. The rove and political connections, the fact that my opponent's campaign manager's wife was running the investigation while her husband was trying to defeat me, the fact that this is the first case that anyone can identify in the history of the United States where somebody's being sent to prison for raising money for an issue advocacy campaign where there's no self-enrichment scheme. I am confident that we will win eventually. We had 113 former state attorneys general, both Republicans and Democrats, who said that, hey, this is not a crime in America. We had the top constitutional law professors from around the country weighing in with the Supreme Court, saying that the law is too vague. You can't send somebody to prison under these standards. There's got to be some quality and quantity of evidence required before you can convict somebody of a crime. The odd thing was, it wasn't against the law. Even if I did what they said I did, it wasn't against the law when I did it, and then they made it a crime during the course of the trial by allowing the jury to infer that there was an agreement.
Oh, my God.
So I feel confident. We've got the support of George Will, for goodness sakes,
right?
A conservative Pulitzer Prize-winning Republican columnist who said that until the Supreme Court hears the Siegelman case, or the underlying facts of the Siegelman case, that contributors and politicians, participate in politics at their peril, because prosecutors have unbridled discretion to pick and choose their targets. So it's a dangerous situation. And as you started this program, and as my daughter has said, who's going to be fighting for my freedom after I am locked up on September the 11th.
Amazing.
If this can happen to a governor, and I might say in a Fortune 500, contributor, it can happen. We had the resources, thankfully. I spent everything that I'd saved, but we had resources to go to court, to hire lawyers, to fight this thing. But, if you think about if you think about the guys on the girls on the street who are subject to being stopped or challenged by or targeted by the government, you know, it's just overwhelming. And you know, we've really got to get this stuff straightened out. I want to make one more comment, and I know I've been talking too much.
No, not at all. This is your forum here.
But Nicole, you said people don't believe that this kind of thing could happen, but we didn't believe that America could go to war under false pretenses of supposed weapons of mass destruction. We didn't believe that this country would allow torture as a means of interrogation, you know, waterboarding. We didn't believe that we would see a country where our constitutional rights would be suspended indefinitely, because of the Patriot Act. You know, there are things that go on, the covert assassinations, the killing without,
due process, without any due process.
Right. You know, all of those things whittle away at what America stood for and what Americans still believe in. But we were we were and can be a proud country again, but we have got to, you know, we've got to center ourselves back on our moral compass, and we are off course. We are off course, and it's not something that can't be corrected. But as you just stated, it is up to us, the people. We have got to do something about it. And I'm asking people to help me get out of prison. I don't want to stay in prison for 6.5 years for something that never happened, something that wasn't against the law. I don't want to stay in prison for one more day because of Karl Rove's shenanigans or, you know, the political manipulation of this case. But you know, I am asking people to go to donsiegelman.org, Don Siegelman, SIEGELMAN.org, and there's a free Don button up on the right. Mm-hmm. If you go there, you can sign the petition to the president. But what we're hoping is that this becomes something more than just setting me free. It's got to be about, you know, it's not about what's left or right or Democrat or Republican. This is about what's right and wrong, and we've got to hopefully get the attention of the president so that if he is reelected, that he will also embark on doing things to reset the moral compass of this country, both in, you know, from the Department of Justice standpoint, from freedom and liberty standpoint, and you know, we've just got to keep moving trying to move the country back in the right direction.
Absolutely. Don Siegelman is with us. Again, the website, donsiegelman.org, SIEGELMAN, and I'll have all the links up on my blog at radioornot.com after the show. A couple of things. One is, the whole premise of this case against you, were a political target. The fact is that they really set you up. I mean, even to the point where the so-called evidence against you was an assistant in the governor's office who claims that he saw this donor coming out with a check. Again, we need to reiterate that you were convicted of bribery, but no bribe took place. It was a political contribution. And today, I brought this up on Randy Rhoads' show on Friday with you. You know, today we're looking at someone like Sheldon Adelson, who was willing to spend $100 million to buy the White House for Mitt Romney. We know there's going to be some real quid pro quo there, where he wants whatever investigation into his foreign practices dropped. I mean, it's right there in black and white. How is that person not in jail and you are? I know that's sort of a rhetorical question, but it just begs for a real examination of what's going on in this country.
Well, it's, you know, there are two ways to look at this. One, there are real efforts to buy favors that are going on, and some of those are very clear in our face. And as you said, there is no investigation, there is no prosecution, there you know, but then on the other hand, there's my case where the money didn't come to me. It was going to help raise, you know, funds for our kids to go to college.
Right.
And, you know, the standard that they used for me was one that had never been used before. So, you know, again, I'm hopeful that people go online and sign the petition of the president, and this thing starts to grow exponentially and gets the White House's attention, and they do for me what they did for Ted Stevens at the beginning of their administration. Mm-hmm. But again, it's a bigger issue than just Don Siegelman. This is not just about me. This is about restoring justice and restoring our democracy and, you know, putting our foot down and saying never again will we allow the Department of Justice to be used as a political weapon, as Karl Rove used it during the Bush administration.
Exactly. Now, yeah. I also mentioned at the beginning that, you know, when a new administration comes in, the standard operating procedure is they get rid of all the U.S. attorneys and install their own, even though Bush replaced some of his own appointees with others who would be more politically friendly to them. That's something the Obama administration never did, and one has to wonder why. Now, the other question is, just a month and a half ago, the Supreme Court refused to hear your case. So, you know, if you thought, all right, well, maybe, you know, we let this go through the courts and work its way up, eventually you'll get justice. What reason did the Supreme Court have to refuse hearing your case?
Well, they didn't give a reason, but
of course
my guess is, Nicole, that if they had said not guilty, or if they had said new trial, or if they had said the court below erred, it opens a lot of questions about Karl Rove, about the Bush administration, about the abuse of the Department of Justice. And my guess is that they just thought, wait, we'll just wait until there's another case that doesn't have all these other questions out there, because, you know, it would raise more questions. It would open Pandora's political box, and it would probably bite the judge, the prosecutors, the Department of Justice, Karl Rove, and a bunch of other people. And I think it was just too much for them, you know, too heavy of a burden for the Supreme Court to bear on this case. So my only hope of getting my personal injustice righted, and the only hope for drawing attention to what's wrong with this case, and hopefully getting the bigger picture of justice dealt with, is for people to go online to donsiegelman.org and punch that button that says Free Don, and let's try to get the president's attention.
Most definitely. Now, I got to ask where the media has been on this. I know Tom Hartman has been really good. In fact, I first learned of your case a few years ago from Tom Hartman. But where is television? Where is that corporate mainstream media? Why are they so silent on your case?
Well, you know, initially, after the progressive blogs and radio, you and Tom Hartman and, you know, other powerful, not mainstream, but powerful media got behind my case, then we began to see MSNBC, you know, Time Magazine, the New York Times, CBS's 60 Minutes on February 24th, 2008, which is also on this website, by the way, donsiegelman.org. I would recommend your listeners go to watch that 12-minute segment on 60 Minutes.
Absolutely.
Of February 24th, 2008, because it makes the connection and exposes Karl Rove's involvement in my case. But it was only because of the progressive media that we got mainstream media. Where are they now? That's a good question. We had a good article in the Washington Post a couple of Sundays ago, but, you know, I'm hopeful that between now and September the 11th, that we can stir up enough interest so that perhaps these you know, some of the others who have covered my case will get back on it.
So now, Don Siegelman, now that the Supreme Court has said they're not going to hear your case, there's no more recourse via the court system, right? The only chance you have of not having to serve the next 6.5 years in prison is for the conviction to be vacated, to be pardoned or commuted, right? The sentence to be commuted.
That's essentially right. We've got one possible appeal that may come about in a motion for a new trial, but the government, the Department of Justice is opposing that, and it'll go back to the 11th Circuit, where we've not had such a good record on this case. So, as a practical matter, yes, the president's commutation or pardon is my only practical hope at this point.
Wow. Now, Don Siegelman again, Don Siegelman, SIEGELMAN.org is where you'll find all the information. There are over 100 former attorneys general from around the nation who have gotten on board and said, wait a minute, this is a travesty. This is a miscarriage of justice. This is wrong. Is there any way we can mobilize all of those very influential names and do something? I mean, I get the petition, but I mean, well, it seems like we should be able to do more here.
Well, yes, I mean, they are still willing to help. Actually, the number has now grown by one. There was another Republican who signed on the other day, so we're up to 114.
Wow.
Former state attorneys general, and they're supporting this cause. You know, I don't know what it's going to take to get the president's attention. One would have thought that we would have gotten it a long time ago.
Yes.
It's a struggle. We just have to keep fighting because, you know, we can't give up. We cannot allow these kinds of shenanigans to go on within our Department of Justice, because if it can happen to me, it can happen to anybody, and it will. This is not something that is going to be an isolated event. Now that they have lowered the standard, in essence, to an implied agreement, if bad prosecutors with a political vendetta, or prosecutors who want to silence a contributor, prosecutors who want to silence a particular politician, they can get an indictment off of just about any contribution that is made to a politician. They can prosecute the contributor and the politician. So, you know, if this isn't corrected, it is going to change the face of American justice, and it's going to change our democracy, because people are going to be subject to the desires of prosecutors to pick and choose their targets.
Why hasn't Eric Holder acted on this?
I think my guess is Eric Holder came out of the Department of Justice. He has served with a lot of people in the Department of Justice. Because he's been there, he has a tendency to trust those people. Even though there are still a lot of Bush holdovers in the Department of Justice. And I think that he has been reluctant to challenge the opinions of those people below him. And I think that's basically it. It's impossible for this case not to have gotten his personal attention.
Exactly. Well, yes, he's got to know what's going on with you. Now, and in my mind, the fact that they have done nothing is just unconscionable. And this is what I struggle with all the time. It's like, how can I bring myself to vote for Barack Obama, given all of your case, given, you know, so much that he's been too silent on. And then all I can think is it's either going to be Obama and his administration in office come January for a second term, or it's going to be the Romney administration. And I hate that I have to resort to this. It's the lesser of two evils. But under a Romney administration, I think there will be no recourse for you, which is even worse. I mean, we will see, you know, the Karl Rove system of government just become even more, I guess, acceptable, which is unacceptable.
Yeah, well, you know, Rove served in, this is before your time, Nicole, but Rove served in 1972 in the Nixon White House under Don Segretti, who was sort of, he was a guy that kind of gave birth to dirty tricks at the White House level.
Sure.
And during that time, you may remember or may not, but, you know, they created something called the Plumbers Unit, and they had a couple of infamous guys go out and do political dirty tricks to kind of try to hurt their Democratic opponents. I think Rove, when he became part of the inner circle of the George W. Bush White House, he decided that rather than creating an ad hoc group to do these investigations and smear tactics, that he would just take over the Department of Justice. And so Rove was given credit, or took credit, for the appointment of nearly every U.S. attorney and federal judge during the four-year period that George Bush was president. I'm sorry, the 8 years that George Bush was president. And by doing that, I mean, he put them through a litmus test to make sure that they were the right people for the jobs. And as you noted, and we talked about during this program, if they didn't act the way Bush and Rove wanted them to, Rove replaced them and put people in who would march to the political drum that he was beating. That is a very dangerous thing for our democracy, for our constitutional rights, and for justice. And, you know, again, if Rove is allowed to get back in, it's going to add weight to those injustices and to the wrongs that will be committed. So I am I'm a firm believer that people have to vote for the best choice, even though, you know, as you said, it may not be the best choice in our own minds,
right,
but it's the best choice for the country.
And the best choice for the choices we have. And, look, my hope is that all of a sudden we'll see the, you know, the hidden progressive in Obama come out in a second term, when he doesn't have to worry about pandering to
yes,
the moderates,
yes,
and the middle of America, and all of a sudden, you know, he'll do the right thing. I'm knocking on wood here. The bottom line is, a daughter of ISIS on Twitter just asked, how can we help? Letters, emails, phone calls. First thing is, go to donsiegelman.org, SIEGELMAN.org. It'll be up on my blog at radioornot.com after the show as well. Sign the petition. But what else? Can we bombard the White House? Can we give money?
Well,
I mean, what else will help you?
Well, you know, I would primarily get this out, get the word out to your friends and family and anybody you can through Facebook and Twitter and we're also, trying to circulate paper petitions on the street and at conventions and getting signatures and having those sent back into Birmingham to my brother, who'll package them all up at the end of the day when we do our petition to the president. But mainly right now, getting the word out to everybody that they need to sign this online petition.
Okay, that is the most important thing. And then whatever else we can do. I got to say, Don, you have inspired a lot of people who hadn't been involved in any kind of action before, who have been so outraged over what was done to you. And again, I said this on Randy's show, I'll say it again. This was done to you. You were targeted, you were set up, you were attacked, and you were wrongfully prosecuted. You've already spent 9 months in jail, right? What is that like?
Well, you know, I think my experience is a little different. I was, keep in mind that my conviction, I was governor.
Yes.
I've been in politics as Secretary of State, Attorney General, Lieutenant Governor, and Governor for about 25 years.
Amazing.
Never had a blemish on my record. never accused of wrongdoing until Rove and his guys came after me. As soon as I was sentenced in the courtroom, I was taken out immediately, handcuffed, my legs were shackled, my chain put around my waist. I was put into a car and taken immediately to a maximum security prison, the oldest, worst prison in America, located in Georgia. I was put into solitary confinement for 3 weeks and then taken to Oklahoma, where I was put in solitary confinement again for another week before I was released to the swamps of Louisiana, where it took my family over a 17-hour round trip to get to me to say hello. So for a month, nobody knew where I was. But, yeah, I guess, you know, my point is no one would want to, and I'm not whining, and I'm not asking for sympathy, but no one would want to go or suffer what my family has had to endure. I want to go back to 2002.
Okay.
Just for a minute, to put things further in perspective about why Karl Rove was interested in targeting and bringing me down. As the Republican from Arizona, the Attorney General, who was John McCain's national campaign chairman, said, Don Siegelman was a Democrat they couldn't beat, so they targeted him with this prosecution. In 2002, I was beating all of the top Republicans in the state. In a Republican state, I had won lieutenant governor and governor. I defeated their top candidates, defeated an incumbent Republican governor to be elected in 1998. I was running for re-election in 2002. I was going to enter. Al Gore had decided not to run again in 2004. So I had been touted as a dark horse candidate by a Republican conservative business newsletter called the Kiplinger Letter in 2002. I was about to launch an effort in Southern primaries to draw attention to George Bush's failed economic war policies and education policies, and I thought that was what I needed to do to help focus attention on George W. Bush's failures. So I think your listeners can also see there was another reason why my election was stolen. There's no question about that. There was, again, the people given credit was, a woman who was the business partner of Karl Rove, and another one who went to work immediately for Jack Abramoff and a Tom DeLay related lobbying company. So the story is laden with political mystique, but the impact is something that's damaging to our democracy, damaging to our Constitution, and damaging to our system of justice. So I'm asking your listeners to not only to help me, but to sign this petition so we can send a message to the president that this kind of thing cannot be allowed to go on anymore. We've got to get this straightened out.
Absolutely. This is a travesty. It's more than that. This is sickening. I the more I hear, and when I hear the way you were treated, I mean, look, I hate to say it. I thought when, you were sent to prison, it would have been like a Club Fed thing. The fact that they treated you the way they did, I'm sickened. Governor, I'm stunned that this can happen in this country, but people need to know that it does, and we need to stop it. DonSiegelman.org is the website. Go share it. Sign the petition and make sure everybody you know signs it. We've got to change this.
Well, Nicole, maybe we can talk again before I'm not able to talk again. And I will look forward to speaking to you. But again, thank you for this opportunity to be with you this morning and with your listeners. Folks, I don't have anybody to count on. Members of Congress aren't going to come to my rescue. The the Department of Justice isn't going to come to my rescue. The only hope that I have for my personal freedom lies with you, those who are listening to this show. I've got to depend on you to sign this petition and to send a message to the president that, we want our country back. We want to restore justice, and we want to preserve our democracy.
Most definitely. Governor, I'm not going to let up on this, and I'm going to do everything I can to make sure everybody within the sound of my voice or the reach of my online presence gets involved. This is just so wrong. And on behalf of the country, I apologize for what's been done to you, and we need to fix it. Governor Don Siegelman, Don Siegelman, SIEGELMAN.org, and it'll be up on my my blog at RadioOrNot.com, too, and everywhere. Thank you. And I will stay in touch, I promise.
Thanks so much, Nicole.
Take care.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
I don't know about you, but I am so sickened by the way this man was treated. This is a good, decent public servant. Here from somebody on Twitter. This is from Incognito, spelled in a creative way. Don Siegelman, a public servant with principles and character. You think that's why they had to take him down? No, because this is the way the right wing of this nation operates. They lie, they cheat, they steal. And we need to turn things around. We need to make sure that that is not the modus operandi here. It's All Groovy says, now I'm crying and pissed. Yeah, sign the petition. The fast shortcut to the petition is change.org/pardondon. You don't have to worry about spelling. You don't have to worry about spelling it correctly. Pardon Don, change.org. Pardon Don. Rarely am I speechless, and I've heard his story. But I'll tell you, this is the first time I heard how he was mistreated in prison, how he was sent into solitary confinement. I'm sorry, that's torture. I'm blown away. And on September 11th, interesting date they picked, he has to turn himself back in again to be mistreated even more? I'm stunned. We need to, I'm sorry, I'm looking at the petition, and there aren't nearly enough signatures on there. It says thank you for 7,781 signatures in 11 days. That's not enough. If you haven't signed it, it's now up to 11,875. That's not enough. They need another 13,000. Actually, they need to get it up to 50,000 signatures in order to get the attention of the White House. So your goal right now is to get involved here. This is something, this is tangible. This we can touch it. This is disgusting. So, wow. A decent, honest man in government. And because of that, he was targeted. There's not much worse in this country than that. Seriously.